Good morning again, and welcome to Bank of Baroda BETAC and to this session, which is presented by Amar Ujala. So please, could you welcome to the stage Yashika Dutt, Raghav Chandra, in conversation with Pragya Tiwara for Kali's daughter coming out as a Dalit.
Hello, everyone, and a very warm welcome. We are just a day away from our Republic Day, and decades after Babasaheb Ambedkar gave us our constitution, not nearly enough of its promise has translated for India's Dalits. Perhaps even less so for those who are at the intersection of caste, class, and gender oppression. This morning we have with us two speakers who with their words and with their writing have attempted to correct some of this deficit. Our first speaker, Yashika, is a voice that blazed a trail in the aftermath of the tragic but hugely symbolic suicide of Rohit Vemula. She wrote a blog about her identity, her relationship with it, and even though she got a lot of pushback initially, the blog went viral because it essentially very potently exposed the fallacy that we live in a post-caste urban world. Our second speaker, Raghav, and of course, lest I forget, thereon Yashika has written a lot more on this subject, including a wonderful book, which is a sort of memoir of growing up as a Dalit. And Raghav has, experienced secondhand. He's been in the Indian Administrative Services and experienced secondhand how insidiously caste operates, particularly in the civil services, and has written a fictional account of the struggle of a young Dalit woman called Kali's daughter. I'll be speaking to both of our speakers today about what it really means to be a Dalit in India right now. Please welcome Yashika and Raghav once again. Thank you so much. Thank you. Yashika, I'm going to start with the blog that I mentioned in my introduction. Can I just have a show of hands? Did anyone here read the blog that Yashika had written? Okay, not enough of you. So could you just give us a sense of what was in the blog so that people have a context to what we're going to be talking about?
Right. We had this conversation a year ago and we had the same question. And two people raised their hands. And even this time, my friend was one of them. And thank you for being here and reading my blog, my friend. And thank you, of course, obviously. So I just want to take a step back and talk about why I wrote that blog.
Absolutely.
Yeah. It's fascinating you, and it's still a little unusual for me that you introduced me as a Dalit author. And I'm able to go around different stages in different cities and talk about being Dalit, talk about what my exact caste location is, what my ancestors did for a job, cleaning. But when I grew up wanting to hide my caste. Not just wanting to hide my caste, but also being actively told that I need to hide my caste. Because if I didn't, then I would be subject to the same kind of discrimination at school, with my friends, in the neighborhood, that my parents had grown up with. And my mom's sitting there, and she's going to be really mad that I'm going to say that here. But every time I would come back from school, I remember being 5, 6, 7, she would say, "Did someone ask your caste today?" And initially, I would be very annoyed with this question, because why was I being asked you know, why was my mother inquiring if someone wanted to know my caste? And she would say, if someone asks you, say that you're Brahmin. And it, at a very young age, I learned that who I was probably was not good enough. Because if it was, why would I need to lie about it? And I grew up with this idea of passing as an upper caste person, and I'm sure many of us know passing is this concept, especially with African Americans who are light-skinned enough to pass off as white people. And they do that because that helps them save themselves from the discrimination that comes with being black. So in my own way, I was passing as an upper caste person, adopting the mannerisms, lightening my skin, with not bleach, but with homemade pastes, trying to understand how upper caste girls made their beds when I was in a boarding school. So I grew up observing and soaking in just how upper caste people behave. It was this other identity that I was trying to create myself, create for myself. And by the time I was in my 20s, I'd perfected the shield around me. And I'd forgotten that I was even a Dalit person, because nobody could look at me then and say, oh, this is a Bhangi girl. They would look at me, they would look at the way I spoke, they would look at the way I dressed, they would look at where I went to school for and assume that I was an upper caste person, because that's how caste system works. If you are from a certain caste location, urban, educated, you speak English, you went to a decent college, you have to be upper caste. And I went on with that identity even when I became a journalist and remained a journalist for a decade. And I chose to write about fashion, not because I just wanted to write about fashion and nothing else, but because it was the safest choice. For those of us who pay attention to fashion coverage in India, it's mostly extremely upper caste. And it was a safe space for me to hide my caste identity, because like I said, people had stopped asking me who I was by then. And when I went to Colombia, it was in the classrooms there that I realized that what I've been going through is a kind of trauma. The fact that I had to hide my identity all my life and become somebody else and have this gap between who I was and who I was trying to be and never feel good enough was a burden that wasn't mine to bear. And soon after that, and I was still dealing with these ideas, is when I came across Rohit Vemula's suicide note. And I hadn't paid much attention to Dalit politics, Dalit writings, or even Ambedkar, for that matter. I was very removed from that world, but I was aware of it at some level. So I remember sitting in this wonderful coffee shop in New York, snowing outside, and I read his letter. And this was the first time I was reading a Dalit person writing in English. And of course, there have been plenty of Dalit writings in English. I just did not have access to it because I was so scared. And I read his letter, and it talked about, you are a mind made of stardust. And he talked about the possibility of Dalits being more than a vote, or more than a number, or more than an identity, but a human being. And it really spoke to me in this powerful way, and I read it once, and I read it twice. And something shifted inside me that I couldn't go back from. And I realized, well, I'm at Columbia, and of course, I hope you read my book, you'll realize that I grew up in a lower class household as well. So I realized that life could have been mine, but I had somehow, because I was passing as an upper caste person, because I was not putting my Dalitness up front and center like Rohit was, I was able to be where I was. And I realized I needed to do something with all this privilege that I had acquired. And I had to do my job. I had to be a journalist. Because everything I had seen in terms of narrative, in terms of conversation, whether it was in newspapers, whether it was online, there were just two things everybody talked about: reservation and merit. And I didn't want to talk about those things. I wanted to talk about the trauma of being a Dalit person, what the burden this identity brings on us, and what it means to completely hide who you are and never feel worthy, never feel valid, never feel good enough. And I didn't want to have outside voices questioning us. I just wanted to create a space of solidarity, of support, and dare I say, the risk of sounding cheesy, love. I wanted that love to exist within the Dalit community. Later, I found out those spaces existed, but for me, that was important. And I wanted Dalits to share their stories of passing as upper caste, what that means. But I couldn't have asked them to do that unless I told the world who I was. And by then, why that matters is because I was a journalist, my byline was sort of relatively known, and nobody could imagine that I was a Dalit person. So I knew that when I told people that this person who you have been reading, writing about fashion is actually Dalit, and I'm sorry, but an untouchable person was telling you how to dress, I was excited. And that's why I decided to create documents of Dalit discrimination, where people like me could unburden ourselves and for a minute be ourselves. And maybe even if we had to go back in the world and just take that burden on again, we could be free. And that's how the blog came about.
You know, it's so inspirational to hear Yashika talk about her relative privilege. And you can imagine what it takes for someone in her position to even use that term for her, herself. But so many of us are completely blind to our own privilege. And the reason why I say this is because as traumatic as her passing might have been, we have to bear in mind that for the majority of Dalits in this country, that is not really an option because they're still bound by wherever they grew up in their village or their district where they cannot escape caste. But, you know, moving on, Raghav, I wanted to ask you, for you, this was a sort of secondhand experience where you were observing how caste works, particularly in the civil services. What made you want to write about it?
You know, India is, today we are bragging of our economic progress in a very, very dynamic way, yet the fact remains that there are social divisions and the caste system is one of those antiquated historical legacies which is still so pervasive that it totally belittles our economic progress. And it's been there for about 2,000 years, ever since the start of the Vedic period. And it is so embedded into every facet of our life that as a civil servant who's entered the elite Indian administrative service, which is really being like enjoying the cat's whiskers in India, to go through the various levels of postings, right from the time you are an assistant collector to the time you are a subdivisional magistrate to the time you are a district magistrate, as a principal secretary urban development, as a principal secretary revenue. We're dealing not with just a few people but with thousands of people. You are amazed by the enormity of the fact that in India we have still not been able to get rid of the caste system. And I thought that if a person like me were not to write it as a non-Dalit, and the last Dalit literature that I've, you know, so I was posted as the chairman of the National Highway Authority where I had an 18-hour job, and for some reason, I got posted as the secretary of the National Commission, which is a constitutional body for scheduled tribes. And I got a lot of time to read the so-called Dalit literature, and I frankly do not think that it should be called Dalit at all. It's ridiculing a very, very fundamental facet of our social life. But the last such literature written by a non-Dalit was by Mulk Raj Anand in 1935. And I said, look, here is, I'm dealing with all these facts about atrocities, about the tortures, thousands of petitions come to us about atrocities done against the scheduled tribes and scheduled castes. There is so much conversation about the Prevention of Atrocities Act. If I will not write it, who will? So I thought as a non-Dalit, it was my responsibility to write it and to describe it in all its goriness. But being a civil servant, we tend to be civil. And so the language that I've used is fictional. I mean, the plot is fictional. And sometimes you can tell a lot more about a subject when you write fiction, because you're allowing your imagination to play, you're allowing outlying facts to also come out up front. And I thought I would just let myself go and write a story be sympathetic to the subject, and let all the facts come out as they should be known by the citizens of this country. And I'm very happy that The Economist magazine has mentioned it as one of the books to be read from India. Lots of reviews which are coming out are referring to it as a book to be read. And I think every citizen of India should be aware of the caste system to be able to get out of this hopeless legacy that we've been faced with. And if India is to achieve any semblance of economic and social prosperity, we must do away with the caste system. And people like me and more non-Dalits should write about their experiences. I've had colleagues who've been Dalits. Some of them are first-rate individuals. I've had staff who's worked with me who've been Dalits, first-rate individuals. I've tried to embed them, inscribe them into my own life. I've been sympathetic to them. I've helped them, and I think they are first-rate individuals. And why should society have any divisions at all? I mean, talking about incredible India or talking about prosperous India doesn't make sense unless we can do away with caste divisions.
Yashika, you talked about the moment at which, very lucidly, you read Rohit's suicide note. And thereon, you started a rather, like you said, something shifted inside you, and you started a very different journey of your own, right? And I was wondering if reading, whether it's Dalit literature or maybe works on race in the US or Ambedkar, that gave you a sort of prism to understand your own experience better. I guess the question I'm also trying to ask for a lot of us who may be uninitiated is, what would be a good reading list, according to you?
Coming out as Dalit.
Definitely. I can endorse that.
Yeah, that, jokes aside, and please buy my book. I think Dalit literature is so important. And of course, you know, I'm sharing stage with Mr. Chandra, and I haven't had the opportunity to read the book, but I'm sure it's excellent. However, I think there is something to be said about who gets the right to tell their own stories. And it's all well and good to talk about caste system should not exist, and of course it shouldn't. I don't want to be untouchable. I don't want to face discrimination. I wish I had the same opportunities as everybody else. I wish I didn't have to pass as an upper caste person. I wish I didn't have to lie about my identity, but I had to. Is that a fact that we are going to reckon with or not? Are we going to acknowledge the kind of violence that's inflicted on Dalits on an everyday basis or not? Unless we can reckon with that, we cannot say that the caste system is invisible, the caste system doesn't exist, or the caste system is over. And in a milieu like that, while of course non-Dalits should have the voice, but Dalits should have the right to amplify their own stories as well. How do you know a Dalit person who grew up in a village in probably Rajasthan, and I'm not talking about myself, first generation, had the chance to go to college for the first time, parents sold land to send that person to college, was discriminated, called a quota person, but wants to write. How does that person go about finding the connections, the network, the privilege to write a book? Who's going to give that person a chance? Is that story worthy of being told or not? Let's ask ourselves that question. In publishing, are Dalit stories worthy of attention? Are Dalit stories worthy of being told? And can we speak on the behalf of a population that till three generations ago was not allowed to read? That till three generations ago had molten lead poured in their throats if they spoke Sanskrit? So let's try and maybe face this idea about Dalits need to be able to tell their own stories.
So, you know, you brought up two very important points, Yashika, and I will come right back to them, but I'll just take one question with Mr. Chandra, which is, you know, you grew up in an upper caste household. I wanted to hear your experience of when and how you started to understand how oppressive and pervasive the caste system really is and how it operates?
You know, my first experience, or should I say, of the caste, this thing, I was brought up in a convent educated background. I went to Lamart near Lucknow, and, you know, frankly, there was no talk about caste in school. At least we were not aware the kind of education we got. I came to St. Stephen's in Delhi. There again, one was not so conscious about these issues. But when I joined the civil service, and I had a friend who was, I think, he was in every way more accomplished and more articulate and better positioned than me to be able to woo the best-looking girl in our group. This person was going very friendly with this girl who was an upper caste Brahmin girl. And suddenly one day we discovered that they were not going around again. And I was shocked to be told that somebody had mentioned to this girl's parents that this boy was a Dalit. And so she'd backed out. And that was my first brush with this abominable, abhorrible caste system, and I realized its intensity, that by the mere mention of the fact that somebody is a Dalit, no matter how well-educated they are, he had education which was no less than mine. He was in every way better. His father had been a chief secretary, and yet this happened. And I think so, when you read this book, and you know, at some stage, if you permit me, I would like to read out a few passages to mention how, you know, caste plays out in its various facets.
Yeah, we'll definitely come to that. It's very interesting that he mentioned St. Stephen's. Would you, and I have two questions already in the bank, but would you like to talk about your own experience in college and if it was any different?
Right, so we both are Stephanians. Yay. But I think we both had vastly different experiences. I remember when I came to Stephen's to fill the form, my first dilemma was, should I avail reservation or not? Because even as, you know, two generations ago, my grandfather learned how to read and write by scrawling a stick in the mud. And the only reason I was in an urban location and had the relative money that we did, which we didn't, frankly, was because my grandfather was able to avail reservation and become a bureaucrat. So when I'm there with my mom, trying to fill the form, and I'm wondering, should I take this reservation, this affirmative action policy that is basically there to create a parity for generations of keeping Dalits away from education? Should I avail this? Am I taking the rightful seat of an upper caste person if I take this reservation policy as somebody who, till two generations ago, her grandparents went and did cleaning work? That was the idea. That was the thought in my mind. Should or should I not take this constitutional right that was given to me? Because I thought that I was grabbing an upper caste person's seat. I thought I would be questioned about my merit, I would be called talentless, I would be called worthless, I would be questioned, how dare a Dalit person even enter St. Stephen's? Because if I took reservation, I would out myself as a Dalit person effectively. So in that sense, I think our experiences were kind of different, but of course when I went to college, being St. Stephen's, we call it college, it is, if not caste neutral, then at least caste agnostic. In terms of other universities, the college down the road, Hindu, which has university elections that are fought on caste lines, their caste is way more visible than in Stephen's. So I was able to have a relatively peaceful existence until it was time for people to fill forms for MBA and the CAT exam and graduation, and then they started saying, tum to quota wale ho, tumhare ko kya karna hai? Tumhare ko to padhne ki zarurat hi nahi hai. Waise hi naukri mil jayegi. And thankfully this wasn't directed at me, because, and sorry for the non-Hindi speaking audience, I said, Why do you have to study? You're a quota student. You availed reservation, you availed the affirmative action policy. You don't have to work hard. You will just coast through. And these were, I mean, and despite having a relatively peaceful existence when it came to caste, I still lived in fear of being outed every day. I still feared that these friendships that I'm forming can disappear the moment they find out I'm not just Dalit, I'm not just SC, I'm Bhangi. I'm an untouchable person. If they find that out, they will they even sit next to me? Was my dilemma. And I fought with that every day. So I think the Dalit experience versus the non-Dalit experience when it comes to being in an elite institution like St. Stephen's, which my parents didn't dream of me being there. You know, they never thought I would be able to be in this bastion of upper caste eliteness. But I made it, and I was worried, how am I going to survive? So I think that experience was completely different in terms of the trauma and the burden that I felt. I love college, but it's just, it's a caste-aware space as well.
You know, I just want to come back to something that you briefly touched upon, and I would like to speak a little bit more about that, which is, you know, you said who's worthy of telling their stories, and you sort of mentioned that let's look at publishing, let's look at how many Dalit people get to tell their own stories. And this cannot be emphasized enough. If I don't have the statistics on me at this point in time, but there is a very, very sobering report on the gross underrepresentation of Dalits when it comes to media and publishing. I mean, the numbers would shock you, trust me. Even if you think you know what is being talked about on this stage, they will still shock you because they shock me. And I just wanted to ask you about how acute that problem is and why it's really, really important to address that and what can be done to address that.
Yeah, so it's acute because I came out and I was one of the three Dalit journalists to exist in India. Three, openly. Of course, there are so many more, and I'm sure now there are way more. But I remember, according to an article that one of my fellow Dalit journalists, Deepta Mondal, wrote, he found out there were three Dalit journals. And that's how acute the problem is. We are 1/4 of the country is 1 billion plus population, and we could produce three English language journalists. And let's talk about the parity. You know, not to make it casteist, but you know, that's where we are. Let's look at who dominates the profession of journalism. There are statistics that prove that Tamil Brahmins are about 1 to 2% in country's population. And if you go in any newspaper across the country's lines, they are editors, they are managing editors, they are taking the decisions. So how is this population so disproportionately getting the opportunity to decide what this country's media narrative looks like? I think that's really important because let's look at the headlines that are chosen. We hear about Dalits being killed. We hear about atrocities. We hear about violence. We hear about reservation. Where are the other stories? Are there only two dimensions to an entire populace, or are we more? It's like, it's a quote about African Americans that said, they eat, they sleep, they have children, and they put them to bed. They don't just suffer violence, and they don't just grab opportunities. There are dimensions to us. And with no Dalit journalists in the newsrooms, those dimensions are lost. And look at the coverage on caste politics. Look at the coverage on caste. I remember in 2006, when I was in college, there was an anti-reservation protest that was done. And media showed images of the anti-reservation protest, which happened at Ames, by the way. Doctors were pretending to be Dalit by taking gigantic brooms and symbolically sweeping them across the roads, saying, if you give us reservation, if you give Dalits and OBCs more reservation, we will become Dalits. Like, it's that easy to become untouchable. I just wish it was. I would really invite them to take my seat. And the way media covered that was by giving it unbiased coverage. There was no context. Hindi and English news channels, we know about them by now. But back then, also, they were pretty toxic. They showed those images over and over again, and they created this, they cemented this narrative of how Dalits are talentless, they are worthless, and they have no merit, and if they are availing the reservation, they don't deserve to be there. And even beyond the media showcasing those images, there were no headlines talking about the pro-reservation protests that were also happening by Dalit students at Ames. Where was that conversation? Who decides what story is worthy, what narrative is worthy of being highlighted, and what's not? That awareness is so hyper-important in our newsrooms, and opportunities need to be created. I don't think it's fair enough to say Dalit journalists don't know how to write in English, because we both know journalists don't know how to write in English. Right? It's and not that English matters. Like, really, it's just a language. I think we should also get rid of our English obsession. It's, we speak Hindi or whatever language we do. As long as we can clearly communicate, that's all that matters. But let's remove this bias about Dalit journalists not having the talent to be in the newsroom and bring out stories that are representative of the truth, that talk about the facts, and that are based on research.
You know, the thing is that when it comes to Dalits being in the newsroom, Dalits being in publishing, Dalits being in the media, the number of barriers are, I mean, they're just numerous, right? You start from a very young age when education is not available in the same way, even after RTE is prevalent in this country. If they do make it to school, then there's discrimination within the school. There is dropouts because of financial conditions. Even if you go through school, you get through school, you go to college, even if you make it, and making it to a newsroom again, I mean, the reason why maybe there are so many upper caste people, Brahmins, who are dominating newsrooms is because of peer networks, right? I mean, at the end of the day, it's how you know, who recommends you, who's mentoring you, who's your godfather or godmother, and who gets you in. So when you, and then you finally, when you get there, you probably don't feel confident enough to walk in and say, I want to start telling Dalit stories. You're like, let me, you know, I've got this opportunity, let me try and be like everyone else and talk about what everyone else is talking about. So we're talking about multiple layers of barriers, but I think one that gets very often ignored is the very subtle ways in which caste works, which she kind of alluded to, which is the sort of the mentorship that you get. Because most Dalits are first-generation college goers, first-generation in elite jobs. They don't have a pre-existing network that can take them in, that can mentor them, that can guide them, and that can sort of push them. Would you like to talk a little bit about this? Because this is, again, something that just gets, like you said, it's either violence or reservations and nothing in between.
Yeah, totally, absolutely. So I just want to start by saying, we talk about reservation all the time, and I'm making a point there, so bear with me even if you hate reservation. It's an affirmative action policy, and it was instituted, like I've mentioned several times now, to create parity in the society. But does anyone talk about the reservation that's existed in India for thousands of years? The reservation of connections, the reservation of networks, the reservation of money. How does a certain section of the society get to dominate a certain section of newsrooms, bureaucracy, cabinet ministries? How does that happen? Is someone telling them what to do? And if you're a farmer, a Dalit landless laborer's son or daughter, or your manual scavenger's daughter, how do you know who to go to? Who's going to tell you that this is the way, this is the form you apply for? Thankfully now the internet has made things democratic, but before that, how do you even get access to that kind of information? How do you prepare for that interview? Who puts that sifarish for you? There is nobody doing your sifarish because you don't have any mentor networks. And that private reservation, which by the way, all non-Dalits have had for thousands of years, thanks to the system that was created for them, that has existed, and that has already been there, but the reservation that gets most highlighted is what Dalits have. We are called the creamy layer. What are non-Dalits? Cafe au lait, frappuccino layer? They've been there. for the longest time. It's just that nobody's paying attention.
You know, Raghav, I wanted to ask you this when it comes to, because we're talking about reservations, and it's interesting that you said that even if you are against reservations, I mean, I wonder who in their right mind, I don't mean to offend anybody, can be against reservations. If someone is, I'm reminded of a wonderful Buddha parable that if you want to end reservations, get me a fistful of mustard seeds from a household that is not affected by caste. Raghav, how, I mean, what is your experience of seeing reservations been like in the civil services? Was it beneficial for Dalits?
You know, even before you talk about, you know, whether it's beneficial, you have to sort of understand that there is a vast resistance to the entire concept of reservations and quotas. And so in the story, right from the day, from the moment she joins the train journey, you know, these boys and girls who've entered the train, which is going to Mussoorie, they are talking about quotas, and very mockingly, they are deriding the fact that quotas exist, and somebody is saying, my sister couldn't make it because, you know, she fell short by a couple of marks because somebody got through thanks to quotas. And all through this book, there is this talk about quotas and how those who are from a superior caste always look derisively at those who've managed to make it through in the service thanks to quota. But here the heroine, for instance, Deepika, gets in without a quota. So you can be meritorious and you don't necessarily have to avail of a quota. A quota is just something which can work to your advantage if you require that little leverage. And now coming to the issue that you asked about this thing, frankly, there are people from such varied backgrounds, and most of them are people who may not have gotten to the civil service had there not been a quota. And therefore, it's very necessary to bring about equality in this country, to bring about some semblance of order, to bring about some semblance of redress in a nation which has been so disaggregated, so divided historically, to have a system of quotas. And I don't see quotas going away in the next 10 or 15 or 20 years. Yes, you can debate whether you should have quotas 50 years from now or 80 years from now, but in the short-term horizon of about 10 or 20 years, and I think we should only look that far, we do require this kind of very, very strong affirmative action, because if you look, even for instance, for the blacks in the US, if you look at the McKinsey study which says that the median income of the blacks in the US has only gone up by this percentage, whereas the median income of the whites has gone up this many more times. So even if India, today we do not have a socioeconomic classification and categorization of and quantification of the incomes levels of the Dalits versus the non-Dalits. But if you were to do them, my strong hunch, based on my experience as a civil administrator who has held jobs at various levels, is that the income gap between the average or the median income of the non-Dalits versus the Dalits has only been increasing. And therefore, you will require quotas. And if your question was to ask me whether people from quotas are bright enough or not, yes, they are bright enough. And I've come across civil servants who have been exceptional. It's just that most of the time, castes, because of caste, they are not often able to rise to the top because of their, you know, the manner in which they dress up, the manner in which they, you know, historical issues, cultural issues can't be done away with in a period of about 10 or 20 years. And quotas is what, 40 years, 50 years old? And caste is what, 2,000 years old? So, you know, you will still require caste. And people from the quota system are some of the brightest. They are some of the most meritorious. It's just that you need to educate them perhaps a little differently. You require more networks. You require more mentoring. And the second generation of civil servants from the those who availed of quotas will be, I think, a different lot. So now, for instance, if Yashika has been to Colombia, her children will definitely be more different from her, you know, own experience, and they will be more liberated. But you have to live in a society which today accepts the fact that there was discrimination historically and which is ready to do away with discrimination, to do away with any kind of discriminatory forms. Even today you have matrimonial ads, which have, you know, if you open Times of India or if you open Hindustan Times today, some of our main mainstream newspapers, they will have matrimonial saying for Jat, for Kayasth, for Brahmin. I mean, and in this book, as Deepika herself mentions, you know, she's recollecting the prejudices that she suffered. She mentions of this particular moment when one particular ad says, non-Brahmins need not apply. You know, I mean, what kind of a world are we living in if you still have things like that? So you do require quotas. You do require to do away with caste. I mean, that's a no-brainer. And if you need to progress, you just need to change yourself. And it is society which has to change itself. You know, I mean, it's not that the government has to do very much. As a social grouping, we have to change our mindset and our thinking. And here I'm talking of the cities, but look at it in the villages. I mean, things are far more appalling. And if you see some of those slides that I've got from just recent cuttings from newspapers in the last 3 or 4 months since my book was released, I mean, they're shocking.
I just want to come to that, but I just want to clarify, I was definitely not asking you, are they meritorious enough, but you have answered my question. My question was, is even quota enough? And like you clearly pointed out, no, it isn't. But something that you brought up, and I think is very important to address, is the intersection of caste and class. You write in your book as well about manual scavengers, about landless laborers, bulk of who, if not all of them, almost all of them are Dalits. And let's remember that when we sit here on this stage and speak of Dalits, they are people who are really the most voiceless amongst the people that we are even talking about. I would really like both of you to talk a little bit about how, and because time is short, I will also include a second question that also kind of comes into play in both your contexts, which is the intersection of gender and caste. Yashika, there's a lot to talk about here. There's a lot to unpack. I think we have about 2 minutes. But when we talk about feminism, in India, generally what we are talking about is Savarna feminism, which has really been extremely blind to Dalit issues when it comes to women.
Can I just take... These are some of his, since he's already played them, can we just run through them at full speed?
I just want to counter, actually, sir, what you said before. Dalits don't dress badly. I just want to say that. Dalits are persecuted for showing signs of vanity. Dalits are killed when they dress well. Dalits are killed when they show a mustache, when they grow a mustache. Dalits, Chandrashekhar Azad Ravan is criticized for being too stylish. It's not our fault if we look the way we do. It is because we have been told that if we didn't look the way we do, we will have our eyes gouged out. So it's thousands of years of indoctrination and fear and casteism that makes us look the way we do, and I think I dress fucking well.
Sure. She deserves a big hand for this.
You know, while the slides are going on, because time is short, would you also just carry on and talk a little bit about Savarna feminism that we wanted
to... Yeah, I think, like, I absolutely agree with you, Pragya. We need intersections of caste and class and gender. And, you know, Dalit women lie at the lowest totem pole of caste, class, and patriarchy. So in terms of Savarna feminism, I think I can just talk about this example when the Mandal Commission protests were going on. Savarna women were on the streets talking about how reservation will help them, will prevent them from getting good husbands. And I think that's a very accurate way of summarizing. Hopefully not now, because I know in the last 5 years there have been lots of strides that have been made. But that's the extent of what Savarna feminism looks like. It's inward looking. And of course, this is not to pit women against women. That is not the idea. As women, we are oppressed as a gender. But when it comes to Dalit women, they also have to deal with being called too sexually available or not having their FIRs lodged by the police, which, by the way, the police and the state can do a lot more for Dalit people than they currently are. They also have to deal with being raped and not having their stories making headlines. So I think that those are things that we need to critically engage with and think about.
One question that I do want to ask you, Raghav, is, you know, it's your book is titled Kali's Daughter, and you use the metaphor of Kali for your protagonist. I was wondering what made you choose that particular metaphor.
So, Pragya, will you let me read out why from the book?
I'm so sorry, Raghav, I don't think we have time for a reading. We've already crossed the mark.
Okay,
what
so
we'll do is we'll take some audience questions and we'll let the audience buy your book to read.
Please do buy the book. Well, so let me tell you why it's called Kali's Daughter. So, you know, Deepika, when she gets into the service, the only god or goddess that they have in their house is Kali. And this is a story. So Yashika, you may not agree with me, but Kali is the only goddess they have in their house. And the logic that the story works on is that Kali is dark in complexion. And therefore, as Dalits, they can relate to Kali. And later on, the story also says how the more fair gods and goddesses have been expropriated by the higher castes. So for instance, Saraswati, Parvati, Lakshmi, they're housed in opulent temples and they're dressed in rose-petaled, colored dresses, whereas Kali is the one who is fierce, who is the Adi Shakti. She's dressed in a, you know, with a garland of skulls, and so she's, you know, with a tongue which is lolling out with blood, and she represents also the ultimate strength in the sense that even she dominates Shiva. So below her feet, she even tramples Shiva. So that's one reason. And later, at one stage, faced with tremendous amount of harassment in her school, Deepika cries before her father. And she says, look, I mean, why should they be doing this to me? And her father consoles her and says, even Gandhiji has said, nobody can trouble us because we are Harijans, God's own children. So she's been crying and she says, that means I'm God's own woman. He says, yes, you are Kali's daughter. That's how
the metaphor
of Kali evolves.
Very quick reaction from you. And I'm particularly curious because you've been fascinated, as I have, by Ambedkar. And of course, Ambedkar said that I was born a Hindu, but I will not die a Hindu. Do you feel like within the Hindu religion, emancipation is possible for Dalits, particularly women?
That's a really tricky question, Pragya, because I have always said that I don't claim to speak for 250 million plus people, and I don't think I can speak on the behalf of anybody else but me. So if that is okay, I'm going to talk about my relationship. I don't think it's possible. I don't think it's possible for a Dalit to be a Hindu. And personally, I'm an atheist, so I have no religion, it doesn't matter. But I know a lot of people need religion, they need faith, they need something to hold on to, and there is a lot of empathy to be found in that aspect as well. But if the basis of Hinduism is discrimination and differentiation, let's not even talk about discrimination because I know the people will come at me for that. But differentiation is the entire basis, and I don't think anyone can contest that. If you are dividing your own people within four major castes, and then keeping some people out, how are they supposed to feel equal, if ever? How are they supposed to have an equal seat at the table? How are they supposed to think, well, I'm going to vote for so-and-so party, so Hindu country, yay, I'll be equal. That is never going to happen. So I just want to say, as far as I am concerned, personal opinion only, it is not a good idea for a Dalit person to be a Hindu and still feel emancipated, because the basis of the scripture is to tell you that you fall out of the system that was created to keep you out.
Okay, so we're going to be able to, I'm sorry I overshot my own time, I owe you an apology for it, but we still have time for a couple of questions which we will be able to take. The lady right here in front. May I request you to please keep your questions very to the point?
Can you hear me? Well, so I'm from Tamil Nadu.
where we don't have surnames, so I'm thanking Periyar for that. So I want you to give me an insight on honor killing. Honor killing and how Dalits really suffer in honor killing. Insight about that.
Are you talking about
honor killing?
Is your question for Raghav or Yashika?
Anyone answer okay. In the panel.
Now, what kind of honor killing is this?
Honor killing is like an upper caste women or men.
Yeah, there have been several instances which we've come across, and they come out in the newspapers from time to time, where a Dalit girl is getting married to a non-Dalit, and the non-Dalit's parents have killed that person. I mean, that's absolutely heinous, and it just goes to show the extent of the caste system, and there's no way we should excuse it. And such people should actually be punished as severely as they possibly can. So, I mean, it's a absolutely clear thing that any kind of crime which is generated by caste has to be dealt with severely, both under the Prevention of Atrocities Act and under the IPC.
Yeah, I'd like to add something to that question. So Ambedkar talked about endogamy and how that's a way to preserve caste, right? And he's also said the only reason caste is propagated is because caste people marry within caste people. And what honor killing does is that it refutes that basic tenet of the caste system. It attempts to dilute caste. It's not that I'm sure there is a level of misogyny there as well, where people don't want women to make their own choice in finding a groom that they want to be probably happy with. But I think it's also more about how dare you dilute the system that gives us the privilege that we have. I think that's what honor killing does most effectively, is to just take them out from the root. No one's going to attempt to marry outside.
Okay, let me just take one from there. Sorry, I'll just come back to this side. There, please.
This is a question for Yashika. Do you think that the tags that marginalized communities acquire, such as Dalit writers or Dalit literature, which is generally considered lesser than high literature, do you think such tags actually serve as empowerment because they serve as representation, or do you think they need to be dropped in general?
Yeah, wonderful question. Thank you for that. Let's question why are they considered lower or worse off. What is wrong with being a Dalit person? What is wrong with writing Dalit literature? Why is it inherently bad? I think more than questioning what label we're giving ourselves, we need to challenge the perception that society sees us with. And I think a lot of us are what we're trying to do here when we sit on stages like these and talk about proudly about being Dalit is to send a signal to 15-year-olds, 13-year-olds, Dalit students that there is a way possible, that there is a way for you to be Dalit and proud and be bright and be on places like this. I think that's what we need to look at. Instead of saying, oh, I'm going to leave this tag because people are going to think I'm not good enough, I'm going to say I'm going to be exactly who I am and make them see me as good enough and bend their will to my knees. That's what I'm going to do.
Thank you very much. This question's for either of you. When I was in middle school, we had an essay story about Krishna and Sudama. They used to study together, king and a person of so-called low caste. And
so-called?
Low caste, you know. And I remember the story very well, that when they go out after the education is over, Sudama's wife tells him, hey, listen, why don't you go to Krishna and ask him for some help. And he goes there, and you know, and what happens is Krishna sees his condition, does not give him anything, but by the time he goes back home, he's already got a new house and everything else. I don't know how many people know about this story. The question is, in the ancient India, whether we have to solve this problem of being by asking the people who have more to be like Krishna and treat Sudama as their friend because they studied together, or we have to perpetuate a system which is unequal. Means we have to treat it from the other way around by changing the perception of the other side as well.
That's what affirmative action is about, to be able to ensure that it doesn't only, you know, benefits reach not only because Krishna is in a position to give it, but government and society as a whole should be able to give back to people who have suffered or who have been discriminated. So, you know, to legitimize it, to institutionalize it, the entire emphasis of the affirmative action thing is to make it equalitarian and to be able to make it just and fair.
I mean, the only thing I'd add to it, if I may, is that we must remember that it is Sudama's right to have a good house and to have a good education, and he shouldn't be at the mercy of Krishna to give him that house. That's all. I get your point, sir. I get your point, sir. The lady over there, please.
As an outsider, I do notice that in your introductions, you're still saying, oh, you're from an upper class family, or you're from a lower caste family. My dad was a chimney sweeper in the Netherlands, but I never introduced, like, oh, I'm Leonie, my dad was a chimney sweeper. I mean, seriously. In this whole conversation, I mean, I really think it's good to have this conversation, let's put that first, but when are we going to say, let's just cut the crap and let's just talk about human rights? Let's not say it's privilege that brought me to college. No, it was your human right that brought you to college. Everybody should be able to get a good education, to get a proper way of living.
I'm sorry, can you get to the question, please?
Yeah, sorry, that's just what I wanted to say. But my question is, how do you deal with this shame that you should not have in the first place? How do you get out of this position of feeling an untouchable, even when you don't believe it's true anymore?
By pretending really hard. By just lying your way through it. Fake it till you make it, and then hopefully one day you make it. No, but honestly, I think the way to do that is to have role models who are Dalit, who are out, who are proud. And I say out because the book is coming out, not in the way the sexual minorities use that term. I think we need to see more Dalit people being themselves and owning who they are. And that's exactly what Rohit Vemula did for me. When he wrote that letter in English, I saw a Dalit person who was not ashamed. He refused to take any kind of shame on himself. And that gave me so much courage to be who I was. And I think in turn, and the book has been able to do that for at least some people. I got this this message from this 15-year-old kid from Kota, who Kota being the city, not the quota, which is where a lot of IIT preparation goes on. And he wrote to me and he said, Didi, and he called me Didi. He said, Didi, I read your book, and for the first time, I was able to stand up to my students who kept saying I didn't have talent, I didn't have merit, and I was able to tell them why they were wrong. I knew they were wrong, but I was able to tell them why. And now I don't feel ashamed. And I still have that message.
If I may add to that, I would say that we should, this whole thing of having these very clunky surnames like, you know, Agarwal, Mittal, Mishra, Tomar, all these, you know, we should just do away with them and have very indistinguishable surnames. That is going to be, I think, the beginning of the beginning of the beginning of the end of caste.
I'll take one from the back over there. The lady over there. Sorry, sir. The lady over there.
Very inspiring to hear all of you. The late M.N. Srinivas, the eminent sociologist, had spoken about the Sanskritization of the Dalit. Now, don't you see the danger of this Sanskritization being co-opted by a party which wants to include the Dalit to be a Hindu?
Absolutely. There's no danger. It's here. It's already happening. I mean, look at who Dalits have voted for in Uttar Pradesh. That Sanskritization is a project that has been created so Dalits feel that they have a seat at the table when in reality the seat at the table is at the foot of the table. They never have an equal seat. They're never getting to sit there. They're always at the bottom.
So I think there is an absolute clear and present danger which is right at our doorstep in terms of how Dalits feel emancipated and feel like they have a chance to be included, maybe for the first time ever.
And of course, we are not talking nearly enough about how CAA and NRC will impact Dalits, but that's another question for another time. I'm just going to take one from here, and then after. I'm sorry, sir. You cannot speak out of turn. I'll get the mic to you. But can I just take a question from here, please? So I'm sorry, sir. You cannot speak out of turn. You'll have to give me a minute. Just a quick question from here, please. A very quick question. The lady there, please. Yes, you. Yes. Can you make it very, very quick, please?
Hi. I just have one tiny question. Yashika, it's to you. You were mentioning about the fact that there's a scriptures which has been written about this Dalit part. I just wanted to know, so I'm a history student. I graduated from history honors, and there's this part in Mauryan Empire when there this particular historian who wrote a stanza where at that time there was nothing based on caste. It was always based on, the discrimination was based on job. So there's one particular stanza where it says that a family of Brahmin, in that same family, the son is a sweeper, the mother is a teacher, and the sister is working on something else. So they used to have these different discrimination tags based on the job. And whereas again, when you go into Mahabharata or ancient scriptures, these caste system has never been there. It developed after Mauryan Empire that came in. So what exactly do you mean about the scriptures that you were mentioning?
Manusmriti.
Sorry?
Manusmriti.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Do we have time for one last question? I'm so sorry. That's all we have time for. I hope you will buy both the books and have a good read. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you so much to our speakers, Yashika Dutt, Raghav Chandra, in conversation with Pragya Tiwara. If you would like to get your book signed by either Yashika Dutt or Raghav Chandra, they will be in the book signing tent, which is out of the building to the left near Mughal tent.